and males differ in the gametes they produce and in their reproductive systems. In many animals, there are additional small or large sex-specific differences that are not directly related to reproduction. This sexual dimorphism is manifested in what is called secondary sexual characteristics. For example, if males have beards and females have none, it has no direct impact on the reproduction.
We are here in the National Park Majete in southern Malawi. This park is a great example how a region in which wildlife has become exterminated can be restored and repopulated. The park is managed by the African Parks Non-Profit Conservation Organization that takes on the responsibility for the rehabilitation and management of national parks in partnership with governments and local communities. African Parks involves the locals in its conservation activities and encourages them to protect nature by providing employment and by building schools and hospitals. The organization runs about 15 parks all over Africa and is doing a very important job. We came here to see these stunning Nyalas, the antelope species with the most distinct sexual dimorphism. If we wouldn't have told you, you wouldn't have guessed that they belong to the same species. The color and pattern of Nyalas serve for camouflage in the thicket, and in males also for impressing females. In most antelopes, sexual dimorphism is manifested by the larger body size of males. Males usually have horns like these kudus, waterbucks, and impalas. In other species, like in these beautiful sable antelopes, both males and females have horns. We spotted these sable antelopes in Liwonde, another park managed by African Parks. Just north of the park, we found this huge hollow baobab tree that already sheltered the famous explorer David Livingstone. Locals meet by the tree and cross the river from here to trade and fish on the other bank. A huge fig tree climbs on the baobab, so this is in fact a double or even a triple tree.
Here we are watching zebras in Hawangi National Park in Zimbabwe. Sexual dimorphism in zebras is minimal, and I guess none of you can confidently tell the males from the females. Of course, when a foal is lactating, we know that this is a female. Presence or absence of sexual dimorphism can often tell us a lot about reproductive strategies. In mammals, the male has in most cases the limited role of fertilizing the eggs. In some of the species, he has to court and impress the female and or fight other males. Therefore, he has to be big, strong, and beautiful.
We have already seen that many mammals have a pronounced sexual dimorphism both in size and color pattern and, as we will learn in the next chapter, in behavior. In contrast to mammals and to most other animals, bird reproductive strategies boast unique gender equality. Most birds breed as a pair and take on similar roles in incubating the eggs and taking care of their offspring. This too will be discussed in depth in the next chapter. Most birds indeed lack sexual dimorphism. There are of course many birds like these ostriches that are sexually dimorphic, a dimorphism that can be explained by requirements of courtship and mate selection. Interestingly, ostriches are one of the few avian species where the male has a multi-female harem. The majority of bird species live in social monogamy that will be discussed later on. In many of the most colorful birds, like bee-eaters, kingfishers, and rollers, males and females look completely identical. Similarity can also be found in many passerines, waterfowl, raptors, and vultures. It remains an open question why birds invest so heavily in spectacular plumage that can also increase their risk to be identified by raptors and other predators. Maybe this is a sort of sexual selection where both male and female choose. Given their gender equality, this would not be that surprising. It might also be a mode of species identification. Male birds lack an external sex organ, so that interspecies mating could, at least anatomically, easily take place. As mating with a different species will not give rise to offspring, this would be a colossal waste of resources. It is thus of utmost importance to make sure to find a mate of the same species, and an eye-catching plumage pattern might be a useful method. We will learn now about insects and their sexual dimorphism from Dr. Netta Dorchin, the curator of the insect collection of the Tel Aviv Natural History Museum.
We are here in the entomological section of the museum. The insect collection is the biggest collection in the museum. We estimate that we have about 3 million specimens in this collection. Insects are the most successful, I would say, evolutionary successful group in the world, because as somebody wiser and older than me has said, to a good approximation, all of us are insects. Everything is insects, because about 80% of living organisms are insects. Insects are dominant components of all terrestrial habitats, including freshwater, not in the oceans, but in freshwater and terrestrial habitats, either as food for other organisms, or as predators or parasitoids, or detritivores. And as such, they have a major importance in every ecological system. And of course, to us as humans, they have a huge importance, either as pests, agricultural or other pests, disease vectors, nuisance, of course, and also positive significance as pollinators. We wouldn't have most of the fruits and vegetables that we are eating, we wouldn't be able to eat without insects, because these plants depend on insects as pollinators. In many groups of insects, the males and the females look differently. Usually the males are more colorful, if there are differences. They have to attract the attention of a female to convince her to mate with them. So they are more showy. The obvious example is butterflies. You can see differences in coloration between males and females. But in many insects, the shape of the body is also different. So males may be bigger. They have longer antennae, they can have huge legs or other parts of the body that the female doesn't have. Sometimes the female is bigger. So for instance, in stick insects or in some butterflies, also grasshoppers or katydids, the females are bigger than the males. They're really fat, they have to store the eggs in their abdomen, so there are differences in size and in shapes of different body parts.
The males of this sand cockroach are winged, while the females are wingless. The females are carrying their eggs around in small bags attached to their abdomen. This one with wings is a male. In the most extreme examples of sexual dimorphism, the male is reduced in size to his limited role, impregnating the female. Such extremes evolved many times. Here, we see a tiny orb weaver spider that is risking to mate with a much larger female. He is taking advantage of her being preoccupied with a much larger and juicier prey than him to mate without being eaten. Let us conclude with anglerfish. The look of these hideous creatures is of little importance, as they live in eternal darkness at the bottom of the ocean. It is very hard to find a mate here, so that once a male is so lucky, he fuses with a female for good. His body degenerates, leaving behind only the testicles that keep on fertilizing her.